I wanted to talk a bit about future-proofing Swift. I worked on quite a lot of projects over the last years. I'm working for 6 years now for the Capitals. I left my footprints in most of the apps shown here. What I found is that using Swift and coding on a daily basis is quite a lot different than sometimes what you read in books, and there are some philosophies you it's hard to explain them in books or in talks, but I'm going to give it a try to share some of my experiences and show some examples on how you can use Swift to write code which is more future-proof. The reason why I wanted to do this is because code lives in an always changing environment. You cannot just assume that the code you write now is still working maybe a day from now or a week from now, or that that your intentions, what you want to do in the code, that that they stay valid. So how can you plan for the future if you're if you have no idea what's ahead? Of course, if time allows it, you should write unit tests and you should do code review. But both of these, they are an investment. They do cost a lot of time, and if you ask me, they are worth it. But some companies are they just don't want to invest in this time. So you're not always able to do this. So what I wanted to talk about is a couple of mindsets or philosophies you can use in your code, and they are usually pretty simple, especially if you explain them. They seem pretty straightforward, but if you keep them in mind in your day-to-day working with Swift, I think your code will be more future-proof because it's more flexible and it doesn't mind if there needs to be changes in the future. So there are three main topics. I will just do a really quick introduction on what they are, and then I will show some examples because, like I said, most of these seem very straightforward if you hear from them, and then I'll show a couple of quick examples using Playground. So I think one of the most important one is avoid assumptions. You cannot let the compiler help you with any assumptions. So if you make an assumption now, you're forgetting about it tomorrow. And if you need to change it, then your code will break because you didn't mind your assumptions. And also one which is, it seems pretty straightforward, but you need to write code which models what you're actually building. But a lot of mistakes are made when you try to model your requirements instead of your what you're actually writing. And that might seem straightforward and might seem logical when you are writing it, but then when there are future changes, you bump into all kinds of issues because the models you use and the setup you use is just not working with these models, and that's basically because you misused something for what it's not what it's not used for. A really simple example could be, you know, you can use integers for dates because an integer is a timestamp and it's a really quick way of representing a date. But dates are so complex that if you make an assumption that the date is just a timestamp, it's going to bite you somewhere in the future. Another one is write shy code, which basically means that if you make code like small black boxes, you know, with just a little bit of input, little bit of output, and it doesn't need to know about what environment it is working in, it's much more easy to change it in the future because it's just blocks, you can move them around. They are small in size, so if you need to understand what a piece of code is doing, you only need to look at small pieces at the same time instead of looking at one just big code. I basically just did it. Here are a couple of quick examples on assumptions which a lot of people made. And if you look back at this, you know, everybody would say, that's a really dumb assumption. But a lot of people did this before when the iPhone 4 was there. They all said, you know, I need to do this animation or I need to do this. You know, the screen is always fixed size, so I'm just going to use these sizes to do my animation. And then the keynote comes and they said, you know, we have a new iPhone, the screen size is different, so you really couldn't believe how many apps broke when the iPhone 5 was launched, just because of the simple assumption that the screen size is the same. And in most of the cases, it's just a matter of, instead of using a fixed number like 320, just asking for the frame of a certain view. There's just no rocket science there, but making these assumptions, which are true at this moment, so you can say, all the screen sizes were actually 320 at that time. So at the time, the assumption was valid, but it is not valid in the future. Basically the same, on iOS 6, you had this navigation bar, it was always 64 pixels. So a lot of people said, you know, the height is always 64. So if you would make a design with a custom navigation bar, it's 64, so we don't need to mind it. There are a lot of assets just 64 pixels high with gradients. A lot of people did this. And then iOS 7 comes out, and the status bar becomes a part of the navigation bar. And again, a lot of people broke, a lot of apps broke, just because of this simple assumption. A little bit more complex one is around dates, like I said before. You can use timestamps as dates, but here are a couple of examples of assumptions which I think a lot of people make, but they're all false. So the solution is pretty simple. If you just use dates instead of timestamps or integers, a lot of this stuff is just handled by the system, and dates are really complex. So please just use dates instead of timestamps when you're handling dates, even if it seems very simple. So the next one is write code that models what it represents. This is a case which I think will become a bit more clear with one of the examples. The example is you see this in the iOS Cocoa frameworks everywhere. For example, animations. If you have an animation block for a UI view, for example, or you have view will appear, view did disappear, they all have Booleans inside the functions, if it's animated or not. But an animation is really an object, you know, it has properties like a duration or a curves or anything. So if you, for example, iOS 12 will come out in the future and there will be different transitions. You know, the navigation bar of navigation controllers now have a fixed animation. It's animated or it's not. But who said that in the future, that'd still be true. So this code is not really future-proof because an animation is not a Boolean. These are the rules, the basic outlines for what shy code should be. But like I said before, it's basically just making a black box instead of what I like to call spaghetti code, which is a lot of strings going everywhere and it's just one big mess and you cannot just take a part out because it's just a mess. Shy code is more like Legos. You know, you have different types of bricks and different kinds of pieces. They all fit together in some way, just like they're intended. You can move them around, place them on different parts, and it will still work. I have prepared a couple of examples. Here it is. Because I think with a couple of real-life examples, it's just a little bit easier to grasp. I'll start out with a very simple one. So let's say, for example, you have a view. It's really small resolution. Let's say you have a view and you have a state for development task. And these tasks, they have a state, like it's in the backlog or... Nice. It's in the backlog or it's to do, and it's just like a Jira board. And you just want to have a certain view which displays the state to a developer. Indicating if he needs to take action. So all the states which are not development related, they should just display a gray state. And if it's a task which is requiring development attention, we want to display some different states. You can have an overview for a project, for example, for all the tasks in which state it is. So you have these states, backlogs, to do, in progress, testing, and done. So then how to determine what color you need to display. So in this case, I would say, I just go over these states. I say if it's to do, I want to display a green state. If it's in progress, I want to display a blue color. And otherwise, the other ones, these are not development related. So I'll just return a gray state. And then you would say this is working like expected because now it's in the backlog and it just displays a gray state here. If I then move it to do, then it needs to run again and then it should display a green state. There you go. So this is all working as expected. But then in the future, you say, I have this to do and in progress, but we're going to do code review now. So there's a new state which we didn't thought of before. So I'll add just in review. But then if you have an issue which is in review, it displays a gray state because the state wasn't known before. In this case, it's just because we use the default case here. So the compiler doesn't help us out. The assumption here was that with the using of the default case, we assumed that all the other states were not development related. But that was true at the moment, but it wasn't in the future. So instead of using this, especially with a fixed set of states, I would prefer to just say here the other couple of cases. So for the backlog, I want to do testing. Testing and done. Points. Because in this case, you made very specific that these are the cases you're interested in when it's another development related task. I also need the new case now. And like this error now, it just gives me an error like you forgot a case instead of just using the default case. So this is a pretty simple example about, you know, using your, or more like specifying your assumptions. Going to do this really quickly. So this is what I already talked about a little bit before. So you have, for example, a view, and it displays an animation. In this case, it's just a random color every 2 seconds. And every even time it's animated, and every uneven time it's unanimated. So that would look like this. And this code, yeah, it does what it's supposed to do, but it's not really future-proof, because the only option we have here is animated and is not animated. So suppose in the future we want to have a different animation than just a fade. Like, for example, we want to flip it around, or whatever the whatever we want, we need to rewrite a part of this code just to make that happen. Well, if you use this, if you put a little bit of thought in it before you start on working on this, you could say an animation that's it's not as simple as it's animated or it's not animated. And there are a lot of ways to solve this one, and it's depending on the requirements, because you can make this really complex. You can make objects from your animation, so you can have durations and you can have all different types. But that will take a lot more time. So in there are always steps in between. So for example, in this case, a good way in the middle would be to have an enumeration, which only has 2 cases in this case, because we don't support any more animations, for example, with the states not animated and fade, because that that would define our assumptions a little bit more. I'm gonna skip a couple. This is another one on how you can let the Swift compiler help you out and make some more future-proof code. So in this case, we would have a delegate protocol which returns data from the API, which would look like this. So then the API call would return any data if it's coming from the API. It's optional because there might not be any data. We might have an error, so we also want to have that. It's also optional because it can succeed and it can give an error. Then we have a simple class conforming to this protocol and just printing out what's happening. So in this case, we make this data handler and we just send it a signal like it received the data, hello world. But there are a couple of problems with this. The first one is, for example, it doesn't specify really what should happen when there's both data and error. That's not really a case for an API. It's either working or it's not working as expected. And if it's working, you want to have the data. And if you want if it fails, you want to have the error. One way could be to make two separate delegate callbacks, like for example the data finished loading with data, and the data failed. But another one could be to introduce a new, like an API response, for example. That should be an enum. And it's an enum because it can either fail or it can succeed. So in this case, we could say this is a success, or it's an error. And then we say that the delegate method would change to response. So now we did define a little bit more about how we want to handle the data and the success cases, because it's an enumeration, so it cannot have an error and it cannot have data at the same time. So instead of using this, we can now just switch over the response. But then still we don't have any access to the data or the error. But Swift's associated types are really good for this. So we can say success that has data. In this case, this is not really a strong typed API, so this would be just any. We could use generics for this, but I won't cover this now because it's a little bit more work for this demonstration. Or we can say this is an error. And then we also have the access to the data or the error. And now we specified our assumptions a little bit more, because what you will see below here is that we need to refactor this one. So there are just two ways. We can either say, you know, it was an error, and it is some examples here. Now autocomplete is failing on me, of course. I don't know what the error now is, but the basic outline, I think, is clear now. We made this a lot more future-proof because we defined what we actually wanted and handled it in this way, instead of leaving all of kinds of undefined behavior. Then I have one last example. And this is more about shy code. So this is an example of a canvas, which is more, you can see it like an image or just some place to draw in. We draw rectangles and we draw ellipses on this, and we render it to an image. And we hope that the playground's working. So we have a canvas, which is an object which has shapes. Shape is just the basic object. It has a fill color, it has a frame, and it has a type. So it can be, for example, an ellipse or a rectangle. And then we draw it to an image. I don't think the preview will work. But there is a problem with this. And the problem with this is that the canvas itself is not really shy code, because the canvas needs to know some properties of the actual objects to draw them. So in this method, where it's actually drawing, it's going over the shapes and say, if it's an ellipsis, we need to draw an ellipsis, and if it's a rectangle, we need to draw a rect. And in this case, these shapes are so simple, it might seem like a good idea to do it this way. But imagine in the future that you want to add different shapes, like, for example, just a Bezier pot. A Bezier pot is not really defined by a shape and a fill color. It also has a pot, it has a stroke. There are a lot more properties to this. But you could make it fit into to what is now a shape. But for example, in the future, you also want to add gradients or masks, for example. These are not shapes at all. That's just a completely different object. So how could we rewrite this so it's more ready for the future, so all your options are open for the future? So in this case, the only thing you actually want from the canvas is know that the shape, that you can draw it somewhere. So it's just defining a protocol, for example. Protocol. It has only a function. And then instead of saying that we have just a bunch of shapes, we just it just has contents. We don't matter what it is. We only want to know that it's drawable. And then we'll say to update this. So that would also make the draw implementation a lot simpler, because we can just go over the items. And in this case, it doesn't matter if it's a shape or if it's if it's a gradient or any shape. You can just make it conform to drawable, and we are able to draw it just in a context. I'm a little bit out of time, so I won't go further and make the shapes actually conform to it. But it could be pretty simple. You can just make a rect object, which is the it could be a shape or it could be a separate object. You could make gradient objects. You can make everything you want, as long as you can draw it in a context. And now this code is a lot more shyer, because all the parts itself, they're really small, and they don't really care what environment they're in. You can just shuffle around elements, and just it's a lot more easy to refactor or add stuff in the future. And that's it. Are there any questions?
I like the last part with the graphics, but the previous part with the animations.
Yeah.
Are you familiar with the term premature optimization is the root of all evil?
Yes.
Apple has like tens or hundreds of methods which has an animated bool.
Yeah.
So now you're going to premature optimize your code for when Apple changes that Boolean into something else, which might be a complete complex structure which you have no idea of, which might not happen for the next 10 years.
Yeah. So
but still you optimize your code already.
Yeah, so yeah, that's why I think the more the middle ground in this would I said like using enum for example instead of a boolean, because
Apple uses a boolean.
Yeah, but I think it would also suit them better if they use use an enum. Yeah, I think it's too late now. but just because you know, it's fine to have an enumeration with two cases.
It
makes it more readable, and you can really say, you know, I want to have this animation with. You could even have an animation type like none and default, for example, and then you don't even need to know what the default is. But for animations, if you have a simple animation, you say it's none, or if it's a fade, and it's just saying really specifically what you want. And I don't think it's any really optimization at all, and it's just as fast as using booleans. It's just a little bit more flexible because you can, you know, you can also help let the compiler help you if there will be a new a transition in the future, because then you have these two cases and you need to add one, providing you don't use a default case in this example. So, and of course, a lot of these. There aren't really good rules for it, so it's more of a mindset sometimes. And there's probably a really good reason why Apple used booleans. And it also depends a little bit on the environment you're in, because if the other view doesn't need to know about what kind of animations you want to use, for example, then maybe a boolean is just fine. Yeah, and I think that's pretty hard because there are no rules on how to do it, and that's also part of why it's really hard to make code future proof, because you have no idea what you're making it for, because you don't know what the future changes will be.
You have really nice examples here.
Yeah.
but maybe in real life sometimes it can be a bit.
Yeah. Yeah, and it probably is, and I think these three main topics, if you keep them in mind and just think about it, and of course, in future changes, you will need to refactor stuff, and I think the worst mistake you could make is make it more vague just because you don't know what the future is. I would even say it's better to just make it more specific, so if it changes in the future, at least it breaks, and then you know what's breaking, so yeah. With the example of using default cases, for example, nobody will tell you if it's breaking if you use a default case. So I would rather say just make it more specific so it does break, because it doesn't matter if you have a compiler error. You know, you can. It's not a runtime error, so if there's a new OS version, it doesn't break because it's just existing code. Especially if you let the compiler help you out with making your intentions only more specific and especially not more vague. That's it.
Thanks, Aaron.